after studying this module, you shall be able to understand organizational culture and its historical development, learn the different models of understanding organizational culture, learn the relationship between work culture, job satisfaction, and motivation, understand organizational climate, learn the antecedents and consequences of organizational climate. Introduction. This module deals with topics that are currently fashionable ways of understanding organizational life, organizational culture and climate. Culture is derived from the Latin word colere, meaning to build on, to cultivate and to foster. It can be considered as an accepted behavior patterns, values, assumptions and shared common experiences. Culture is a complex system of traits, values, customs and morals shared by a society that shapes the way in which a society creates, sends, stores and processes information. Climate, on the other hand, connotes the general weather of the organization. It refers to the psychological atmosphere of the different departments and units in an organization. Organizational psychologists have lately become interested in this concept because of its relationship with other variables like job satisfaction and performance. Organizational culture is subtle, intangible, and enduring, whereas organizational climate is the general morale of the organization. Climate of an organization is affected by the structures and processes of the organization and in turn affects employee performance and satisfaction. These two interrelated topics shall be dealt separately in the module. Organizational culture. Organizational culture has been defined variedly by different researchers. For instance, Spencer Ophie proposed the following definition. Culture is a fuzzy set of attitudes, beliefs, behavioral norms, and basic assumptions and values that are shared by a group of people and that influence each member's behavior and his or her interpretation of the meaning of other people's behavior. Hall views culture as often subconscious. Culture has always dictated where to draw the line separating one thing from another. In the West, a line is drawn between normal sex and rape, whereas in the Arab world, it is much more difficult for a variety of reasons to separate these two events. The most famous and quoted definition of organizational culture has been provided by Edgar Schein. Organizational culture is a pattern of shared basic assumptions learned by an organization as it solved its problems of external adaptation and internal integration, which has worked well enough to be considered valid and therefore be taught to the new members as the correct way to perceive, think, and feel in relation to these problems. In conclusion, it can be said that culture consists of various factors that are shared by a given group and that it acts as an interpretative frame of behavior. The different definitions proposed by researchers have identified certain common themes that describe the essence of organizational culture. Those themes are described as follows. Organizational culture is shared. The norms, ideologies, assumptions that define the culture reflect the common experiences of organizational members. Organizational culture is stable. Once formed, organizational culture is fairly stable over a period of time. Despite any number of changes that may occur in the organizational event, certain elements continue to remain the same. organizational culture evolves slowly with the changes in the external and internal environment of the organization. Organizational culture has depth. It includes not only the shared values and norms, but also assumptions that are taken for granted by the members. Organizational culture is symbolic, expressive, and subjective. The meanings are interpreted from various experiences and structures within the organization. The culture can be symbolized in the form of organizational artifacts like vision, mission, logo, and physical layout of the organization. Organizational culture is grounded in the history and tradition. It is the outcome of the past and the way the organization effectively handled various challenges over the period of time. The leader's vision, success stories, and ways of thought reinforced in the past become a part of culture of that organization. Organizational culture is transmitted to the new members of the organization through the process of socialization. Culture gets transmitted to the newcomers and remains stable for a fairly long period of time. Organizational culture provides order and rules for organizational existence. It results in decreased cognitive load that results from employees sharing an understanding of how things get done in the organization. Organizational culture has breadth. Sheen in 2010 has noted that culture pervades throughout the organization and affects all aspects of how an organization deals with tasks and operations. Organizational culture is a source of collective identity and commitment. The individual's identity gets merged in the identity of the organization. It leads to an emotional connection with the organization and produces commitment. Organizational culture is unique. Organizational culture is based upon the unique history of a particular group of people. Therefore, no two cultures are exactly alike. Theories or models of organizational culture. Edgar Schein model of organizational culture. Edgar Schein conceptualized organizational culture as having three distinct levels. The first is artifacts and symbols. This is the first level. Artifacts are present at the surface of the organization. They refer to those elements of the organization that are visible and tangible. For instance, the company's physical layout, architecture, clothing of employees, structures and processes all reflect the artifacts and symbols which are a part of that organization's culture. Symbols and artifacts are visible not only to the employees but also to people outside the organization. The next is the espoused values. This is the next level of understanding culture. Though espoused values cannot be directly seen as artifacts, they are the general standards and values that guide how an organization expresses its goals and objectives, philosophy and strategies, and the ways in which they are espoused by the management and made public. Sometimes conflict may arise when what management espouses is not in accordance with the basic assumptions of the organization. The next element is basic underlying assumptions. This is the deepest level of organizational culture. It consists of the basic assumptions which are unconscious. That is, the employees are unaware of them, and these assumptions are rooted in the organizational culture and manifest themselves as being self-evident and unconscious behavior. They guide the working of the organization and people are largely unaware of them. Values and beliefs, the second level, when repeatedly tested and validated, become shared assumptions that remain unchallenged for fairly long periods of time, until and unless there is an organizational crisis. Sheen emphasized the role of socialization of the new employees in the organization. The culture of an organization is learned through the process of interaction with the older employees who tacitly transfer the assumptions to the new employees. Organizational culture is formed when an organization comes into existence. The situation in which it emerges and the leaders who provide the vision of an organization play an indispensable role in the formation of the organizational culture. Over a period of time, these visions and values get tested and become a part of the collective unconscious of the organization. Sheen's organizational culture model also describes the process of cultural change. According to Edgar Sheen, in order to bring about a change effort in an organization, discussions with the employees should be held as far as possible. Because till the time the tacit assumptions of the members are not uncovered and brought to light, they will remain unchallenged, and hence change initiatives are likely to fail. In fact, Sheen himself worked as a process consultant for many organizations, helping them learn to diagnose their problems and bring about a change to ensure competitiveness and survival. Cultural types. Deal and Kennedy's model of cultural types is based upon differentiating organizations on the basis of two factors: the amount of risks the organizations are willing to take and the immediacy of feedback after an action has been taken. Feedback and reward. Feedback and reward are considered as important sources of motivation to employees, as they drive the people towards goal accomplishment and inform them whether they are doing a good or a bad job. When the feedback is provided immediately after the action or performance, the ineffective and inappropriate behaviors get corrected, and this leads to a consistency in the culture, since the ones who do not act correctly either leave the organization or are sacked. When the feedback process is slow and does not arrive on time, it can lead to uncorrected mistakes and also reinforces inappropriate behavior. It also helps people look further out into the future. Either way, there is likely to be some substitute activity, such as process management, to help keep things on track until actual results are known. Risk. The second important dimension across which organizations differ is the risk-taking behavior. Uncertainty and risk are hated by some people, whereas others may thrive on it. In those organizations where risk-taking is low, people are willing to take risks till their acceptable limits. In those organizations where the risk is high, people can get innovative and creative, but they need to be managed. Companies high on risk are more likely to select those people who enjoy gambling and friction. Based upon the two dimensions of feedback and risk, Deal and Kennedy have provided four different types of cultures prevalent in the organization. They are represented in the given figure. Work hard, play hard culture. This culture encourages the employees to maintain a high level of low risk activity. These organizations believe that success comes with persistence and consistency. These organizations are characterized by rites and rituals involving energetic games, contests, and meetings. This action-oriented culture is ideal for people who thrive on quick, tangible feedback. But quality is sacrificed for quantity. There is also a lack of attention and thoughtfulness. The culture requires great respect and cultivates young people. Examples of organizations include real estate, computer companies, automotive distributors, and door-to-door sale operations. Tough guy, macho culture. This culture is characterized by the presence of risk-taking individuals who are eager for immediate feedback. These organizations are short-term oriented and are unlikely to learn from failure. The culture fosters immaturity and distrust amongst colleagues. Examples of such organizations include management consultancies, media, venture capital, publishing houses, and sports. Process culture. These organizations are classic bureaucracies. The concentration is on the process and not on the outcome. Natural response to absence of feedback is caution and protectiveness. There is presence of jargon and special language in the organizations. These organizations may also have specific greeting rituals. Examples of such organizations include government offices, heavily regulated industries, as well as some banks and insurance companies. Bet the company culture. This culture is characterized by high risk but existence of slow feedback. Decisions are slow and consultative in nature. These are often ponderous, deliberate companies where good ideas are given a proper chance to show success. These organizations move slowly and are vulnerable to short-term fluctuations and cash flow. Examples of such organizations include mining companies, large system business, architectural firms, insurance companies, and banks. Hofstede's cultural dimensions. Hofstede's dimensions of corporate culture are based upon empirical research that was carried out by Hofstede in the 1980s. He surveyed around 116,000 IBM employees from over 50 countries. From the obtained data, he identified four bipolar dimensions. They are explained. The first was power distance. It refers to the extent to which weak members of the organizations accept unequal distribution of power. It also represents the level of inequality that exists in the society in which the organization is operating. Organizations with high power distance are characterized by greater centralization, more supervision, more value of white-collar jobs compared to blue-collar jobs, and pyramid structures. Organizations operating in India, Brazil, and Mexico. Organizations operating in low power distance organizations are flatter, have less of centralization and supervision, wages are compressed, and people are valued equally irrespective of the level at which they are working. Example, organizations operating in Australia, Denmark, Sweden, and Norway. Individualism versus collectivism. On the individualistic side, the ties between the employees are loose and they are concerned about their individual goal achievement. Organizations are impersonal. Example, the USA, Canada, Great Britain, and Netherlands. In collectivist organizations, people are organized into cohesive in-groups that are strong and have unquestioning loyalty. Organizations operate like families and defend employee interest. Practices are based on loyalty, sense of duty and group participation. Example, organizations in Greece, Mexico, and Venezuela. Masculinity versus femininity. Masculine cultures value male-oriented values like assertiveness and competitiveness. Sex roles are differentiated clearly. There are fewer women in qualified jobs. Example, Italy, Australia, and Venezuela. The feminine cultures, on the other hand, value more feminine-oriented values like sharing, caring, and sensitivity. Sex roles are minimized. Organizations do not interfere with people's private lives, and there are more female at qualified positions. Social and not only material rewards are valued. Example, Thailand, Finland, Sweden, and Denmark. Uncertainty avoidance. This dimension deals with an organization's tolerance for uncertainty and ambiguity. Cultures high on uncertainty avoidance have more formal and written rules, more structured activities, more standardization and specialization, ritualistic behavior, and aversion to risk-taking behavior. Example, France, Portugal, Japan, and Peru. Organizations operating in low uncertainty avoidance have less structured activities, fewer written rules, more generalists in the organization, and less ritualistic behavior and willingness to take risks. Example, Denmark, Sweden, Great Britain, the USA, India. The Hofstede's framework has been often criticized for being too simplistic, assuming homogeneity and universality across cultures, and having too few dimensions that define a culture of society. Despite the limitations, this model provides useful insights about the existence of different organizational cultures, which are largely influenced by the society's culture. Organization culture's relationship with employee satisfaction and motivation. Organizational culture and job satisfaction. Researchers have revealed a clear and a strong relationship between culture of an organization and the job satisfaction of the employees. One study that was undertaken by Sempain et al. Found that job satisfaction significantly predicts the perception of organizational culture. Those who were more satisfied with their jobs perceived the culture of the organization more positively, like better integration and customer orientation, than those who had poorer satisfaction with their jobs. Chang and Lee in 2007 analyzed the relationship and interaction between job satisfaction, organizational culture, and leadership style among 134 private field employees, including bank employees. The results showed that organizational culture and leadership styles influenced job satisfaction in a positive way, especially when the employees shared the vision of a transformational leader. Sherbagi and Zahari in 2012 studied four cultural typologies: adhocracy clan, market and hierarchy culture, and five dimensions of job satisfaction, viz. Rewards, benefits, supervision, operations, and co-workers' satisfaction. There was significant association found between different organizational culture and facets of job satisfaction. Organizational culture and motivation. Ritchie in 2002 has explained that when the rewards given to the employees are aligned to what employees values, then they are more likely to embrace those rewards as their own, leading to better motivation. This process also created intrinsically motivated employees as they perceived their behavior as the right thing to do. Ritchie in 2002 mentions that a feeling of love and belongingness is created by strong organizational cultures and thus lead to increased commitment and motivation in employees. Gannon and Newman in 2002 argued that a considerable amount of research indicates that culture often plays a significant role in determining who is rewarded and how. Framholtz in 2001 argued that organizations with a weak organizational culture in comparison to organizations with a strong organizational culture are less likely to achieve organizational goals because of the perceived link to motivation. In one study, Sinha et al. In 2010 assessed the impact of organizational culture on motivation level of managers. The results expressed a significant and positive correlation between the technocratic culture, that is the cultures where the decision makers are chosen for a governing office based on their technical background and expertise, and role motivation. The researchers reported a significant negative correlation between the autocratic culture and role motivation. Organizational climate. Essentially, organizational climate can be seen as a component of organizational culture. The difference between the two is unclear. Organizational culture as a concept has been borrowed from anthropology, whereas organizational climate has been an organizational behavior construct. Forehand and Vaughan Gilmer in 1964 defined organizational climate as the set of characteristics that describe an organization and that distinguish the organization from other organizations, are relatively enduring over time, and influence the behavior of people in the organization. Tegwery in 1968 emphasized that organizational climate is more related to the perception of the individual employees rather than being a feature of the whole organization. He defined organizational climate as a relatively enduring quality of the internal environment of an organization that is experienced by its members, influences their behavior, and can be described in the terms of the values of a particular set of characteristics of the organization. The following attributes of organizational climate have been identified by Tegwery 1968. It is a synthetic and molar concept like personality. Climate reflects a particular configuration of situational variables. Climate is also continuing, though it is not as enduring as culture. Climate is determined by its characteristics as well as by attitudes and expectations of other person. Climate is experientially external to the actor, who may feel that he or she contributes to its nature. Climate has potential behavioral consequences. It is capable of being shared by several persons in the situation and is interpreted in terms of shared meanings. Different types of climate. Rousseau in 1988 has given a useful distinction between four types of organizational climate. The first is psychological climate. It is individual perception of their environment. It reflects the employee's experience of the environment of the organization. Psychological climate is affected by individual thinking, styles, personality, cognitive processes, and social interaction. Aggregate climate. It includes individual perceptions of climate averaged at some formal hierarchical level. Example, department, team, unit, organization, etc. This climate is constructed as a result of membership of employees in an identifiable unit within the organization or the total organization. This conceptualization of climate assumes that certain organizational groups have a climate and these can be identified through tests of significant difference between units. Collective climate. This emerges from an agreement between individuals regarding their perception of behavioral contexts. In contrast to aggregate climate, collective climates are identified by taking the individual perceptions of situational factors and combining these into clusters reflecting similar climate scores. Organizational climate. It is a descriptor of organizational attributes expressed in terms of characterizing individual experiences with the organization. The descriptors used in order to understand organizational climate have a summary quality in terms of how organizations feel to the people within them or who deals with the organizations, such as the customers. The causes and consequences of organizational climate. The causes or antecedents of organizational climate can be categorized into three broad factors. The first are the external forces, such as economic, market, political, social and technological factors. The second are the organizational history, that is, the culture, values and behavior patterns of the organization. And the last is management, that is, the organizational structure, processes and leadership pattern. In one study, Moxens and Eielsten in 1991 demonstrated that training provided by an organization affects organizational climate. Researchers have distinguished two kinds of influence of climate on individuals. The first is a direct influence that affects all or almost all members of the organization or some subunit of it. The second kind of effect is interactive influence, which exists when climate has a certain effect upon the behavior of some people, a different effect on others, and no effect at all on still others. These factors affect perception of features that constitute organizational climate, namely autonomy, degree of structure, rewards, consideration, warmth, and support. The perception of organizational climate is moderated by group, task, and personality of the individual employees. These factors in turn affect job behaviors like motivation, satisfaction, and performance. The effect on job behaviors is moderated by personal ability and personality of the employees. There are certain limitations to this model, and they need to be rigorously tested through more researches. The empirical support received to such models of climate is rare. The possible reason is that different researchers conceptualize and use the term organizational climate very differently. Summary. Organizational culture and climate have been hot topics amongst the researchers. The two concepts are interrelated and yet different, as culture has deep roots in unshared assumptions that members of an organization share with each other and is relatively more stable and enduring than the concept of organizational climate. Climate, on the other hand, is the general perception of organization by the employees, which is affected by external and organizational factors and in turn affects job motivation, satisfaction and performance. In this module, we have focused on the history of organizational culture, different models of culture and its relationship with salient organizational variables like job satisfaction and motivation. We have conceptualized organizational climate and have tried to differentiate it from organizational culture. A model explaining the antecedent and consequences of climate has been explained. Future theorists and researchers need to validate these models further, as they have received little empirical support till date.